do something.
Yeah, we turn around and face an audience. Yeah. It's like,
should we? Wow, he's sitting right in the back.
Okay, I'll just welcome you all, and thanks for coming to the Politics of Art School, the Black Art Movement Then and Now. So I'm Raisa Kabir. I'm part of Creative Collectivity, which is a QTIPOC artist collective. I'll just read a little introduction for it, which aims to create radical grassroots space for queer artists of colour to interrogate the politics of art in relation to queer identity, institutional racism, and anti-colonialism. And so this event today is just going to bring collective creativity, which I've got some people here from the collective which I'll introduce later, and some members from the Black Arts Movement in the 1980s. So what we're going to start with is a film that as collective creativity have done, and this is called Redefining Legacy, Navigating Practice as Emerging Artists of Colour. And this was done with the help of the AN Go and See Bursary Fund. And we did this as part of researching the archive, looking into people of colour artists and black artists, and at the Making Histories Visible Archive in Preston at the University of Lancashire. So I'm just going to play this film, and I hope you enjoy it.
Not going to be a presentation as such. This is really an open discussion conversation. So the facilitators, that'll be me, Raji and Raisa, when she's here, we will kind of lead on with a statement or a question, and then we'll kind of open up to the floor. So one of the first questions that we posed was, what does the Black Arts Movement mean now to young artists working today, and also those involved in it originally?
I mean, how are you using that now? What do you feel constitutes the Black Art Movement? Because in a sense, like, it was never defined at the time. So in retrospect, I mean, how do you see it?
I totally agree with that. I think I think about that in terms of how it's been presented in terms of literature, books, things like that. So I guess when it's been written about, rather than kind of the artists themselves, I guess they probably wouldn't have considered it a movement. Maybe it is even a problematic term to kind of conflate people who didn't necessarily actually identify with each other, other than the fact that they were black. But this is actually part of the conversation, I think.
I think for me, it's been really, I was art schooled. I came out of art school in 2000. And even at that point, I wasn't aware of the Black Arts Movement. So I think for me, it was really important to kind of have to see that there was some sort of movement, whether or not, in reality, that was, if it's perceived in a different way. And I think that was kind of the first entry point to that. Well, for me, I feel like it was important to kind of, that it existed, because I feel in collectivity, comes some kind of empowerment. But then to kind of, to just look back at it kind of romantically, or without hearing directly from people who experienced that, what that was really, is limiting. So I think that's why we would like to have this conversation today, for example.
Going back to the 70s and 80s, when I was growing up in the Midlands, we used this term, black, and it meant all of us, you know. So it came out of like the riots that were going on, and you know, and as artists, we were able to come together and work together, and quite often our artwork was quite political, it was quite activist as well. And then, you know, there were loads of kind of conflict, there were loads of debates. I wrote this very in the 80s, in the early 80s, and there started to be divisions within the communities, and that got lost.
This was a group of people making work, and that latterly it comes to be known as the Black Arts Movement. Mm-hmm. So it's more than saying, once you look at art history, you sort of say, well, what happens in these specific discrete periods? And if you say, well, at this point in time, there's this idea of a Black Arts Movement, and there's an idea that this Black Arts Movement symbolises certain things that aren't necessarily coming out of the mouths of the people involved in that movement, then I think that's ripe for critique, and it's ripe to say, well, what supposedly was this movement supposed to achieve, and has it been achieved, and where can we go from here? So it wasn't dismantling what happened before, it was saying, that's there, let's build on it by doing something else. I do think it's, you know, the Black Arts group as a group was really important. I sort of say that in the piece, that there was foundational things that happened, and the activity that was carried out by the people in that group and the Sankofa film and all those different things was like a critical mass and helped move towards the point where things could start to happen in the 1990s.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I was trying to write myself into this discourse by saying, hey, I'm not represented here, and I don't feel that my generation is represented either. Not to say that the generation that's gone before hasn't done amazing work. I tried as far as I could to sort of state that.
We would go to events, we would go to conferences, seminars. You and I had interacted in one of these conferences where it did become an us and them. It very much did become a case of, okay, look at the kind of young artists, and, you know, any opinion that we would express would get shut down. You know what I mean? And it became very apparent that we were seeing things very differently, that the politics of why and how we make work has changed, like it has. And that's why we realised we needed to be talking to each other.
Yeah. And these conversations are exactly the same thing. You could drop it in major cities in the US, in Canada, in the Caribbean, and I dare say, although I've not been, just from folks I know that are back and forth from the continent, different parts of Africa, about the notion of who came before and this disconnect between our young people and their elders and the work that is happening within Black arts and cultural movements. The need for us to, which is what I think this conversation is saying, better document and archive. That's why this is, that's the gap internationally that's happening, is there is no one place or no place respective to particular cities or locations where you can go and get that. So as a young writer or artist, where would you go to get that information?
If identity is constructed, who is it constructed by? Whom does it serve? And according to what ideological commitments? And, you know, I know for me, my experience at art school was one where, you know, I wasn't really told a lot about black art, whatever that is. But the stuff I was told about, I was like, nah, that's not for me. You know what I mean? And I found myself really rejecting it. And I think it's actually quite common for young POC artists to be like, whoa, like this is too, you know, it just seems very like essential. Like it seems like it's very much an attempt to describe or to say this is a black identity. And of course now, kind of looking back, I have a more developed knowledge, and I can see the more kind of something that was a bit deeper and something that wasn't so much about being really fixed, but actually that is how it gets framed a lot of the time. So I did find myself rejecting that. I did.
There is some uncompleted work in terms of describing the kind of history of the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
I think there is something there which we haven't as yet really explored the archive of. But it exerts a kind of force, an invisible force, on this idea of a particular kind of political essentialism at the core of work in the 80s. I think that kind of missing part of the archive is a real examination of the history of the Black Art Gallery.
I'm wondering whether, because obviously the word black in the 80s was a kind of political idea of black. It was about displacing the kind of American or kind of essentialist idea of black in more politicized ideas. So is, I'm saying, is POC or is this kind of artist of colour appellation an attempt to forge new language that addresses the particular constellations of issues that we're facing now around identity? Because obviously those issues have shifted.
There is this massive, the student populations that come out of institutions, they have this goal, they have this idea, they want to make money, they want to be famous. And it's the I would say, the kind of neoliberalist way of looking at art as a commodity to make art and be successful, very different to maybe radical or socialist forms of art where you're trying to destabilize those structures of power. And that's the kind of difference I see, and where you see how POC artists fall between those scales of politics, left or right, and what their end goals are. Is it the supportive, collective model of working, which I think what we were trying to like establish, or the very individualist, I'm going to make it, I'm going to cut everyone loose because I want to get ahead and get, you know, a big show in here and here, and I want to forget about any sort of identity politics or liberation or anything like that, or looking at capitalism. I just want to make the work that, you know, is seen as populist or seen as institutionally correct.
The title of which is called Black Art and the Burden of Representation. So I just kind of wanted to put that out there because a lot of what's in the essay, as well as what Charlie has been talking about, is this question of a burden of representation that is kind of projected onto the black figure and the black community, communities.
It's about the shift in the 80s.
We're definitely going to keep this going. Okay. Okay. Yeah, thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming. Thanks for sharing.
So I guess we wanted to start by asking you about this archive, how it came to be, what your intentions were with setting it up, and also how it came to exist within the space, within the university.
So, Susan, in fact, thought it would be a very good idea to have a collection of all the exhibition materials, you know, invites, statements, reviews, some images, that all the members of staff had. So in other words, their kind of website, but there wasn't such a thing, in a box. In my house, I had all these books, all these letters, exhibition materials, magazines, everything. I have got a big house, but I didn't really want it to surround me the whole time, because if you've read through them, which I have to admit, actually, you've probably read more of that stuff in recent years as opposed to at the time than I have. So there comes a point at which actually you don't really want to read it, because what can you do about it? So I really have reached a pitch where, which is how I get with my work sometimes, where I want to just throw it away, really, take up tons of space, what am I going to do with it, what use is it? So I said, look, I think I want to chuck all this stuff. And Susan said, I don't think so. Why don't we transfer all that from, you know, in its various, fairly organised way, but not like it is in those grey boxes, from the house to here. So that's when we kind of really set up the Making History Visible project, specifically to say, in a modest kind of way, this is the sort of thing we're doing. And within what we're trying to do, how we're kind of trying to shift the perception of what black artists are doing or who they are now, we have some material that's to do with them. Because I was very anxious that people of 25, 35, didn't think they had to reinvent the wheel.
Yeah.
Because yeah. it's depressing to find that you're doing the same thing when you didn't need to do it. And all of us would say, don't bother doing that. We've done that, and you just have to point at these archives or, and say, look, they were doing that in the 1980s. We're not doing that now. They called themselves that in the 1980s. We don't want to call ourselves that now. We were, these are our agendas. These are their agendas. That's fine. We think they're okay, or we think they're not okay. But this is what we want to do now.
And I'm interested in this idea of sustainability. How do you negotiate? Yeah. How do you keep going and, you know, and negotiate the failures, the successes, all of that stuff? I mean, I know this is a very big.
It is really, really a difficult question because, in a way, whenever I say, well, Sandra needs a package, you know, because I, of course I've got a solution, because of course I've got an answer, but, you know, there were years when I had no idea how we kept going. I mean, I think in many ways, the way to keep going is, well, the way to keep going really is never be rude to anybody that you meet on the way up, because you'll meet them on the way down. Okay.
Yeah, brilliant.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll be getting back together later anyway.
Yes, we will. So. Yes, and then we can talk
exactly. Off the record.
Yes, I don't know.
Collective creativity started its journey into researching Britain's history of radical political black art because so many of us had it missing in our own art educations. The quest to piece together the timeline and colour in the gaps has led us to redistributing resources, excavating artists' legacies and histories, and in turn has bolstered our own individual practices. By understanding and critiquing the black arts movement and the hidden queer threads within it, recreating these conversations of reflection in a way that enables us as queer trans artists of colour to look forward in our own archiving and creating radical space for QTIPOC creativity in forms of research, visual documentation and exhibitions.
Okay, well, I will introduce the rest of our panel. So we have Evan Fikoya, Rudy Lowe, and Raji Rage, who, as well as me, who are part of Collective Creativity. And also we've got Keith Piper and Saeed Adrus and Claudette Johnson, who are part of the Black Arts Movement and working in Nottingham during the 1980s. So I can invite those two to come sit at the table. And what I'll do is I'll get everybody to talk a little bit about themselves and their practice. Before I go into that, a little bit on the format of today. What we tend to do at Collective Creativity in the sessions that we hold, as you'll have seen in the film, are quite informal, very conversational, and audience participatory. So, you know, we are encouraging people to get involved and not be afraid to ask questions. So I will, I'll hand over. We'll start from this side, and we've got this image up here of a poster, so each people can talk a little bit about their work and who they are. So, Evan.
Okay, hi. So, yeah, my name is Evan Ifakoya. I am an artist. I work primarily in video and performance, and I investigate a lot of different things. I'll just use this one. Okay, but I do a lot of stuff kind of with archives and kind of appropriated imagery, you know, in that kind of like historical or kind of popular contemporary imagery. I work with that stuff quite a lot in my work. I also work as an arts educator, so I do a lot of stuff kind of with young people around kind of arts and kind of addressing kind of the politics of identity and whatnot through different artworks.
I'm Rudy Lowe. I'm a visual artist and an arts facilitator. I do a lot of work around Black British identity and history and around mental health in the context of queer Black identity. I work a lot with libraries and archives and community spaces, so I'm kind of interested in making those links between Black British identity and, you know, using archival material. So I mainly do drawing and making zines and kind of printmaking. That's it really.
Cool. Hi, I'm Roger Rage, and I'm a visual artist and also a writer, and I work with performance, live art, and unspoken narrative, and I use sculpture in various forms in my work. And I'm very interested in the use of interruption in my work. So I try to work with space, space and gaze, and doing public interruptions in different spaces, and using embodiment and using my own body, my gender non-conforming body, in space. I also work with archives, and I'm very interested in migration and the politics of migration, such as migration of labor, migration of cloth. And I use archival images that I project directly on my body to kind of, I guess, examine the tension and conflicts that come up with the diasporic body. Thanks.
Oh, hi. I'm Keith Piper. And I'd really like to kind of thank the collective for inviting us this evening. I'm an artist and a lecturer now. I suppose the kind of context for me and so is that both of us were actually here at college in the 1980s. In fact, I think we started at the same time.
Yeah,
yes,
around 80.
In 1980. 80. And so we were both from here in that period of 1980 to 1983, which are actually really key times in terms of the fourth formation of all of these arguments, and hopefully we can get into a conversation as to what it made those particular years, and the kind of years which came just before that, the kind of late 1970s, so key in terms of all of these conversations. And so I'm really fascinated now in terms of the way that you as younger artists reflect back at that moment. I also teach now at a Middlesex university on the fine art department. And something strange has happened there over the last 3 years, in that suddenly there seems to have been an influx of young Black artists in that university. I mean, they were there in the past, whose concerns have been the normal concerns of kind of young artists. However, in the last three years, there is suddenly a clump of artists who are making work around these issues. They've actually formed themselves into a group called the Black Nation, and they scare me to death because they're even more extreme than we were in the 1980s, or so it seems to me, but that's just because I'm old. And so it's really interesting just to reflect on that and why at this particular moment in 2015, 2011, young folk are re-engaging, in a sense, with those kinds of ideas. And so I'm really interested in that.
Mm. Well, thank you. I'm Sai Andrus. Well, thank you all, the group here, collective, you know, as you introduce yourselves. And Keith for introducing. I don't want to repeat myself, and Keith has kind of said that I was at Trent.
Sorry.
No, it's okay, it's good, thank you. I work across media, and of course, to a certain extent, I was kind of influenced from some of the work that was happening around, like Keith said, late 70s, isn't it? You know, the image and text, or the kind of the issues about race and culture, and subsequently some of the work that I was doing, or one was doing, and then overlapping. I think Keith was involved radically in terms of its. So that kind of early influence of history and politics and what we may call uprisings from the 1980s or whatever in Handsworth, London, that had kind of a impact on my kind of some of my works over the years. And Nottingham, I lived, actually, I kind of went away after, briefly, after graduating, and then I came back and stayed here for like 10 years or so, 80s, 90s, and then did work with youth and community and recently with New Art Exchange in the last few years. So anyway, I'm kind of glad to be part of this conversation.
Thank you, Saeed. So Claudette Johnson's running a little late, they will join us, but here's an image of her work. So collective creativity as a collective, you know, for, you know, people of colour, artists who do identify as queer and trans or intersex, is about, as I said in the beginning, about creating space and creating space for conversation and dialogue. And with that, you know, we may have seen in the film, you know, us talking about being disenfranchised with the arts education that we received, and, you know, why we're, you know, here at Nottingham Contemporary, which we're really excited and happy to be at, and with the Glenn Ligon exhibition, looking at, you know, the role of politics and art, and you know, the decolonization of art education, and why is it so centered on whiteness and maleness as well. And so we're going to start off. We've got like some questions lined up, but we can center some conversations around. And we're going to spend around 20 minutes on each question, but really they're quite broad, and just to get us to have a dialogue between, you know, some artists from the Black Arts Movement and the collective creativity here today. So we're going to start off with looking at the global and the local, looking at the representation of UK POC artists. What we find a lot of the times is artists from the US tend to be they tend to be centered in the exhibitions that are shown in the UK. So, you know, the US versus the UK, who shapes the discourse on black art? You know, is that important? Why is it important to build and create our own British story narratives in terms of anti-racism politics in our work? Okay.
Who's going to start on that
one? So if anyone wants to jump in or have any thoughts on it, or, you know, because I know we've talked a lot about this.
Are you talking about a particular narrative which is shaped now? I mean, like in the wake of last year, this year, you know, the kind of major shows of Black American artists which have happened,
yeah,
you know, in London. What was it last year that you had all those wonderful shows all on at the same time?
Yeah.
Just now.
David
Hammonds and
the David Hammonds,
Glenn Ligon,
Glenn Ligon. Yeah, all those shows. And it was amazing.
Four or five shows.
Taking studio, and show after show after show. It's amazing. And so there is that kind of thing now. But all are you talking about the kind of influence of American artists to the shaping, to the initial shaping of the discourse in the early 80s or
maybe
whatever?
Maybe a little bit of both. The fact is, we've seen a rise or an upsurge, you know, in you know, American black artists being shown in, you know, all over the UK, and that's amazing. But also about, you know, when we talk about who shapes the discourse on black art, it tends to be we are always looking to across the pond, you know, the artists tend to do better there, or they've got more established resources there, rather than perhaps concentrating what's happening here, when there is such an amazing legacy of British black artists or POC artists. And I guess it's just about joining those two threads together, and if you can have a conversation about it.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, it's something that I've noticed as well, like being in London and kind of, you know, working around different kind of institutions in London, that actually when you do have major exhibitions of kind of black people of colour art, it is always kind of outside of, you know, the United Kingdom. And I kind of wonder, well, you know, are there not loads of really amazing, black British artists who have kind of really established practices? Why is it that the major institutions always kind of look to, the Glenn Ligons here, he also had a show in Camden Arts Centre recently, Cara Walker, and I'm not trying to take away from those, really amazing artists and their work. It's just interesting how, I would just like to see some major shows, from people like you guys, Like, I just wonder, do we think there's a reason for that? Is it coincidental? I'm just, yeah.
I'm not sure if it is. There's something else there.
Yeah, there's, I think it's more complex.
And there's an obvious one. Now, what if there's anybody here from the Nottingham? It's economics, yeah.
You think it's,
all of these artists, all of these, and there are a couple of obviously also in this country, like Steve McQueen and Chris Ophelia, etc. They're all backed by extremely wealthy commercial galleries.
Yeah.
And what is happening now, that public funds are squeezed for all these institutions, an extremely rich commercial gallery can come along and say, here's a show of our artists. And they can bankroll a lot of that stuff. You know, they have the financial muscle to kind of bank that bankroll big, big shows for artists to come into centres where, their particular budget is squeezed. And I'm not sure if that's the case. Is that the case? I don't know. I've just heard that as
yeah, sorry?
But, yeah.
No, go on. What's your point?
Okay, can I just maybe
can I just say something?
Yeah, go.
Well, anyway, it's quite interesting, this debate. Not only mentioning that, the word 30 years when we were kind of at Trent or whatever, in Nottingham, in the last 10 or 5 years, the practice has changed for any artist of colour or any artist generally. And there's a tendency, I might be wrong, but there's kind of 200 people or 200 galleries, I don't know, control the kind of the art world generally. And in a way, there are influential people in London or UK and then in States. States, US is a much more commercial kind of driven society in terms of culture or visual arts or whatever historically. I'm talking about historically since post-war. So it has had a kind of a major influence there, much more larger from my kind of experience and overview in terms of geographical, even money and the patronage, etc. And it's really interesting what Keith has just said about these certain artists like David Hammons, whose work that I like, and very kind of influential and very political work that he used to do and still continues to do from States. He had a show with a so-called Blue Chip Gallery, what's called White Cube, in London recently. So in a way, and these kind of artists like Steve McQueen, they do not want to be kind of cold black artists. I have a feeling, yeah? Or Chris Ophelia.
We look at the work.
Exactly. The imagery. Definitely the subject matter, etc. But it's quite interesting that the kind of the generation of the 90s time, and I think Eddie Chambers has kind of commented and a few other people about that sort of commercial, what you call patronage in one way. And another way is that today we have an example that we're sitting here discussing this issue, which has been important then in the 80s and even now, issues about race and representation. But interestingly, we've got this sort of artist from US in a major space here in Nottingham. So in a sense, it's quite an interesting junction and whatever. Why isn't there kind of, I'm not saying Rashid Arena, whoever, let's say, in that it could discuss this kind of legacy of this particular work. So it's kind of overlap. I don't know who can who's calling the shots from States or from here. I think the energies are in both ways. Interestingly, if I may say so, Eddie Chambers, who wrote a lot about this and he's been a curator and I've worked with him and of course Keith has worked with him for many years, he teaches in States at the moment in Texas somewhere, and he's researching and he kind of writes. So it's interesting to view his kind of position or his writings and things like that, because he's kind of in both places.
Mm. I mean, I'd like to step in here and say something to draw on your point about racism, and there is racism in the institution, and I don't know the answer for sure, but what I can say is that, you know, speaking about people like Rashid Arin, who was really critical of the institutions, you know, I feel like he became quite bitter about, you know, the whole art world here, and I think there is something to be said about local, you know, the local versus the global, where local artists often are not heard or given space because they raise critical issues about, you know, society and art institutions directly. And it's interesting, I know just in my experience, they are, like, I'm getting a lot of work within Europe and outside of the UK, and when you want to do something here, people don't really want to hear what you have to say. You know, and I think that it does come down to maybe making political work and being critical. I think maybe it's different when, you know, there are economic, you know, considerations, there are other considerations, but there is something to be said about, you know, that there is racism as well. Yeah.
I certainly get your point about getting opportunities in Europe, because I graduated from art college the year in 79, the year before the Eaters' Law. Why is said I didn't feel it was racism? Because quite a lot of these artists, like Ellen Gallagher, Donald Locke, Carol Walker, Wan Getchi Mutu, are brilliant artists. Mm. I want to see them. Yeah. I'm glad they came. Mm-hmm. But I did feel, why aren't we giving those opportunities?
Yes.
Mm. You see, so it's complicated.
Yeah.
And I said to myself, maybe they're being backed by billionaires or something. Mm. And that doesn't happen to us. So I feel nervous about calling it racism. But certainly, I was discussing this with a colleague this evening, there is a vicious classism or something operating in Britain, in the arts world, where it excludes us even more than we feel, for example, in Europe, or Africa, or America. That's my thing about it.
I guess to build on what Roger was saying as well, though, in terms of the racism, maybe part of it is, you know, in terms of being racialized artists or having racialized art, it's easier for institutions here to deal with the idea of this sort of foreign racism, mm-hmm. and being able
exactly.
to say,
yeah.
oh, well, look, you know, by bringing in these black artists from America, look how racist America is,
yeah.
without mm. having to have something that's really yeah. affronting mm. and local, mm. you know.
Mm. Yeah. And then they can send them back
yeah.
and not deal with it.
I mean, it's interesting because we were at the V&A at that talk, which was
disseminating
disseminating black identity, and the way they framed one gallery owner was like, oh, you know, when we were talking about Frank Bowling, like we had to call him an American artist, and that's how we sold him to sell him. So that's true. Is there anyone else in the audience that wants to speak or come in?
Oh yeah, somebody
here. If we could,
I'd just like to say, I think if we look at the background where Chris O'Feely comes from, the educational background that Steve comes from, I think, like, the London institutions, my lecturer said to me, if you want to be an artist, you can't stay in Derby, you can't stay in Nottingham, you can't stay locally, you have to stretch yourself, you know? London has a huge art scene internationally, so I think it's much to do with the educational background and the kind of the, I guess, the profiling of the universities that these artists are coming from. Because we look at, like, 30 years ago, when they had the, in Goldsmiths, when they had, you know, young British artists, you know, coming out. It was also the institution they were coming out of. It wasn't just about them being great artists, but it's having a platform, you know, the support, the institution. I know my friend who is in Newcastle, mm-hmm. she's gone to the MoMA to do an internship. So it's also about having a platform, I think. And the classism, I do agree with, because there is a lot of kind of classism within institutions. You know, the Tate gets backing from the public. You know, they get their funding from public and also from the amount of publicity, you know. Because there's a lot of great artists out there that don't get the publicity. You know what I mean? There's a lot of people sweating every day, you know, trying to pay for their studio space, and they're not getting that backing. So I think it's also a lot of people coming from, say, a rough area. They're almost scared, maybe, to kind of go for those opportunities. Say, MoMA, no way, not me. Do you know what I mean? That's not going to happen. And I think it's about putting confidence and giving young people and artists the platform, you know.
Yeah.
And these institutions need to support artists more, you know. These institutions need to reach out, you know. It's these kind of things, these collectives, that help create a platform for people to have dialogues, like a platform for artists to actually, you know, hear, you know, voice out. So I think it is a thing about your educational background that really has to do with what institution, because at the end of the day, they do see a form. Before they see you, they see your application. Before they see you, they see what's on the paper. So if what you've got on the paper reads well, then, you know, you have sort of, you know, advantage, I guess, than other people. So that's just my opinion.
That's really great. Yes.
Keith, did you want to respond?
I just kind of wanted to pull together a few things from this evening, because I kind of find it, I feel like I'm in a bit of a time warp, and it's not in a negative sense, well, maybe. Because I remember kind of having these conversations and thinking a bit like, you know, where the support, how am I going to work as a black artist when I used to work more in the live art arena. And I'm kind of really surprised that I'm hearing artists that are a few years after myself saying there's no support, you haven't got this. Because I remember saying those things, and I just think that's shocking, to be completely honest. And I think that I kind of hear what you're saying as well about the whole thing about education. And you know, I went to Nottingham Trent, I had some really good lecturers, I was really supported, I came out, I did work, I networked, I found people, and I did my thing. And I think more than anything, I want to say, be yourselves, do what you've got to do. But I'm really intrigued as to where is the Arts Council. I read not too long ago, put up my Facebook page, because they were saying we need to support, you know, diversity artists. And my question is, where's the representation here today? And perhaps you need to use your voice to speak to them and knock the doors and say, this is what we need. Can you bring it, please? Because we want to say what we've got to say. And that's just what I want to throw in. Okay.
That's great. Because I think, like, you know, I know I went to, you know, a London institution, and a lot of times when we were having our conversations as Collective Creativity, you know, it was the institutional racism that, you know, I think on, you know, Chelsea Fine Art, they don't have a single, you know, home black student on their course at Fine Art. But I know that, like, you know, I think Sonia Boyce went to Wolverhampton, was it?
Yeah.
You know, you went to Nottingham. So I think maybe like a few years ago, you know, 30 years ago, whatever, you know, you went to a school, you know, in the Midlands or the North, and it still worked out, it was still okay, but the London students can be really harsh. Who wanted to respond? Was it Keith? Okay.
No, I think this is an incredibly important conversation, conversation around how the art world is constructed, how, as artists, we navigate or don't navigate our way through the various gateways, etc., etc., etc. And I'm kind of caught between understanding how important that conversation is, I'm actually feeling a little depressed by that conversation at the same time, even though it's so important, simply because whilst we're having this conversation, it seems that once again we're actually not excavating the actual themes and the ethics within the actual work itself. And in a sense, there's a really interesting thing raised here around the sort of aesthetic and conceptual dialogue which takes place between artists here, artists in the States, artists in the Caribbean, artists in Europe, and the way that has actually shaped the way that these histories have evolved. Now, that's a really interesting conversation. It's an interesting conversation. It was interesting in the 80s, you know, because those were the moments when we began to become aware of these other artists. It was interesting in terms of the kind of dialogue around the Anglophone diaspora, which is here, the Caribbean, the AM States. And so it's really a fantastic thing that we're seeing these shows, that we can be exposed to all this work. And I really would like a kind of conversation about what is the work doing And you know, how does it then feed back into what young artists are doing here? Now, how has it fed this history? Because in a sense, all of this is dependent on the work becoming more and more interesting. And the work becomes more interesting by building on the stuff which has already been made.
Definitely. But yeah, like concentrating on the work is entirely, you know, paramount. And I think we were talking about just a bit earlier today that, I don't know, the students in art schools now, or just, you know, even after I've been at art school and going back and sort of, you know, speaking to students there, you know, there is a resurgence in, I don't know, something going on, people wanting to have these conversations. So I think this neatly moves into our next question is, how do we want our art to be framed as artists? And so it seems very broad, you know, as POC artists, as queer artists, as QTIPOC artists, you know, how is it, you know, we're making the work that we want to make, but what happens when galleries or curators contextualize it in a different way or reframe it in a way that you don't want it? So what... how do we want our art to be framed as artists? I don't know if Rudy or Raju want to start, or whatever.
I guess one of the things that it makes me think about is that there's a lot of young artists at the moment, you know, who are working in universities and who, you know, like recent graduates, who are kind of taking hold of this idea of being a QTIPOC artist and making work around that particular identity. And maybe, yeah, what is that in the context of, you know, black LGBT artists who have already been working and been established? How does that differ? And, you know, how has the conversation kind of moved on? That's what it makes me think about.
Oh, is it me?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize. Okay. For me, I just... would like to re-question what art is and how we define art, because I feel like a lot of people get left out of the art industry or the art world, and the kind of work that they're making might be different to the kind of conventional sense of what art is. So I'd like to, I guess for me, I would like to reevaluate what that is, because I make work that I don't necessarily want to be in a gallery setting, and I do public interruptions into, you know, public spaces, and, you know, is that considered art, or is it considered activism, or, you know, what is that, and how do I then show that in a gallery? But then, you know, there's lots of other people making different kinds of art, using the internet, showing their work online. So for me, I guess, yeah, that is a question that's raised for me.
I guess the problem is also when your work is essentialized and different parts of your identity become erased, or people literally just put work in a certain, you know, in a certain tick box, and sort of leave it there and say, you know, this is black arts, is separate to the rest of the art world. Don't know if, Saeed, you wanted to talk anymore?
Yes, I think I welcome a couple of points raised here by the panel that there. I feel that after so many years, three decades, I think the art kind of itself was the kind of debate around the early days of 80s that we're talking more about the politics and not the actual artwork. And I feel that somehow today it's very important that the work itself has to be good and quality-wise or whatever, at least be like discussing like what we're trying to do now. And rather than get bogged down too much with issues about racism or whatever, that exists, it's not to undermine or kind of underplay. It's a very kind of complex network in terms of operating as a visual artist or any kind of visual person or creative. Generally, in a lot of places, whether it's UK, Europe, or States, I think, you know, you've kind of, and today we're faced with this sort of star system. Maybe it always was there. It's more prominent now, so that the art schools, I have taught at art schools here. I taught part-time even at Trent many years ago, and then in Norway and Switzerland. And, you know, I do kind of now and again teach at art schools. So lately, I'm not quite sure of the latest development, but, In some ways, at art school, when I was there, there was hardly any kind of talk. I mean, the time was different that in terms of how do you practice outside and when you leave that kind of course or institution. Of course, there are more opportunities, more frameworks today, but it's much more competitive as well. And in my case, talking personally, and I could do work with what you call arte povera materials, really cheap. And even today, But I'm just saying, in those days, maybe I didn't really worry about making money from my painting, and maybe the living conditions were cheaper. I was in Nottingham for 10 years. I think I produced something interesting, and I was quite happy with it, rather than being in a bigger city. There might be more opportunities in New York or London, but it was much more competitive. Mm-hmm. And I kind of avoided that. But maybe it's partly due with I used to live in Europe, in a small country, kind of decentralized metropolis. It's not a metropolis, Switzerland, you know, sort of. And the other thing is, somebody mentioned something about Europe. My experience in Germany or Switzerland and Italy, maybe Italy, I don't know. There are regional towns and cities that have got some commercial galleries much more than in British cities, like Birmingham or Manchester. They have public institutions in Germany, in Frankfurt, in Köln. It's much more decentralized kind of visual arts practice. In Munich, it's not only Berlin or Köln that's important. They might have shows. And Italian cities are like that. So I think in London, everything is kind of focused. It's very much kind of centralized mentality. Maybe it's kind of historical, the way politics is sort of. So that in itself filters down to the practice of the artist. The colleges might be, the good colleges all over the country, in UK, but the infrastructures vary. So that kind of has an impact on how you practice, and that's talking from personal experience.
Yeah, and I think as well to kind of touch on that, and also, the Rice's question around kind of how do we, want our art to be friendly, and also what you're saying about is the question, what is art? I think actually it's more kind of, how do we position ourselves? Because I feel like art is, I feel like that's kind of an existential question, but it's like actually how do we want our work to be positioned? I think we have to be quite active or kind of have agency in how we want to position our works, and I don't know, can we leave that up to somebody else to determine whether what we do is art? I think that has to be our own choice, and I think there has to be a kind of active positioning in that, but then I think also sometimes it can be taken away from us, that choice about where we get to go, where we get to sit. And I also think that today I think there, people have kind of touched on people like Steve McQueen, Chris Afili, who actually, when they were coming out, they made active decisions to not position themselves in relation to the Black Arts Movement. They very consciously didn't want to be connected with that. And I think that actually that has something to do with them, their fame, I would say, actually, because they actively took this separate stand and wanted to see themselves as emerging in isolation, which for me is kind of problematic, and that's partly why we do this work, because we don't want to see ourselves in isolation. But actually I think that it can do something to you when you make that decision.
I guess as well, like looking at kind of something that Saeed was saying about how hard it is, especially in some parts of the country now, just to get by as an artist. How does that process change the way that people want to be framed as artists, whether that means that people strategically frame themselves in a way because they know that they're going to be making more money if they do that, and how that what is the effect on sort of the politics of people's art when people are framing themselves in this way where they think, okay, well, this is going to be the most beneficial thing to my career, because if I frame myself within this context, then it means I'm going to make more money.
Oh, yeah, there's a question over there.
Sorry, I found it quite interesting when you're talking about Chris Afili distancing himself from the Black Arts Movement, because I feel like since sort of like the YBAs and Saatchi and all that, it kind of made people go, that's what the art world is about, that kind of hyper-capitalistic post-Thatcher sort of thing. And it's made it all very, I remember I studied at Brighton University, and I think in the whole 3 years there was only two people of colour on the course. And since then, I've noticed how the scenes that were made from that university and that course have just sort of really worked with that post-Saatchi culture to help each other up and get as a scene, and have it very much southern, very much in London, living in, you know, Dalston and all that, you know. I don't know. I just found that kind of interesting, and I thought it might be an interesting thing to talk about. But, yeah.
It's like this this idea of a nuanced or a covert politics, where something is kind of under the surface, but doesn't speak out or isn't very explicit in its politics. And as you were saying, the hyper-capitalist neoliberal way of looking at art as, you know, a very commercial product. I guess, you know, one thing is, you know, when we make art as a product of healing or a product of surviving, yeah. Are there any other points from the audience you'd like to chip in? Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry, this person and then this person. But anyone else who hasn't spoken before, you're welcome.
I just wanted to chip in quickly on Christopher Lee's behalf, because Keith tried to say it. I don't see that he was positioning himself in any way. His work is explicitly black. He's chosen to live in Trinidad. So that's not someone who is racially positioning himself away from identity.
I've never, I mean, the argument which I made, and the argument which I would make, yeah, absolutely,
yeah,
is that if you look at the work very specifically,
yes, yeah,
you know, it's clearly,
yeah,
a conjuring with black aesthetics.
No, I'm supporting you and saying, let's, you know, just take him out of that equation.
Well, it's all of those artists, yes, in a sense. I mean, all of them are, in a way, you know, dealing with black subject matters. And in terms of Steve McQueen, you know, even though in a lot of his work, you know, the kind of black body has been there, however, it hasn't dealt overtly with where them those subjects. In terms of his film, the latest one,
yeah,
you know, the greatest piece of work ever produced by a black artist at any time.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of 12 Years a Slave, you can't get any more of a black piece of work than that. Absolutely. It's just incredible. And so in a sense, how he is very intelligently positioned himself in a place where he could then make, you know, the most, you know, powerful statement it's possible to make. You know, because you could access, yes, the money.
I'm just wanting to flag that, yeah, up. Whereas people like Dinas and Jake Chapman, whom I also went to college with and taught with, clearly are just running after the money. So that's the point.
Who I are they?
I don't know if that's true.
Anyway, I thought Kabina Mercer said the YBA was young black artists.
No, young
black artists. Kabina Mercer said. It's quite interesting. YBA phenomenon.
Mm-hmm.
I heard that there were some English artists from London had to go to States because the YBA was so strong in London. And it's kind of, unless you come from a certain college or certain period, certain artists found it very difficult. But it's a different issue as well. And, you know, sort of all sorts of...
But I guess what, you know, we're still talking about men here, you know,
yeah,
you know, when we talk about, you know, some of the women artists or the, you know, the people who had a more of a queer perspective, that maybe get left out of that kind of, you know, as the forefront of your mind is these are black artists. You know, if you're only going to be talking about, you know, Chris Ofili, yeah, Kishoni Barr and Steve McQueen, like, I think, like, you know, multiple identities are people who are, you know, have a politics that's centered on so many different fronts, and that gets lost. And if what gets pigeonholed as that's just black art, then what if they're talking about gender? What if they're talking about sexuality? What if they're talking about, you know, class and disability? And these are things that I think are, like, really important to talk about as well.
I don't think any of us would argue against that. It's just that we were speaking about those artists because those are the artists that the arts mainstream.
That's why I mean the mainstream still,
yeah, and that was that
picks that out.
Yeah.
And I wasn't criticizing what we were talking about here. I was just making it out, like, these are things that, like, straight away, these are the names that come up. And yeah, I just want to move the conversation along towards multiple identities. Evan, do you want to talk a bit about that? Oh, Raju?
Oh, well, I was just going to say, you basically said it though, but you know, the fact that, you know, me as a person, I'll talk personally about myself. I'm an artist who makes work about race, but I also make work about gender. I also make work, you know, about lots of different things, and I sometimes I feel like, okay, I have to kind of only fix on one of those things, and I can't, you know, it's like leaving parts of yourself at the door, and I really struggle with that as an artist, and I think we talk about that a lot in terms of, you know, we've been invited to spaces as POC artists, but then talking about being queer or talking about sexuality is something that gets erased or you know.
And then the work is misinterpreted.
Yeah.
You know, if someone's saying,
that's
happened to us. Like, oh, your work's just about Muslim women. No, it's not. No, it's not.
Yeah.
And I think, yeah, to kind of continue on with that, because I guess something that, you know, well, I feel like I'm noticing anyway amongst our contemporaries is that, you know, there is a lot of really great kind of people of colour artists and collectives working and operating, and I'm talking really just specifically about London, but you know what I'm noticing in terms of kind of the media representation of those, you know, artists and collectors is you know, those who focus on solely exploring their racial or interrogating or deconstructing their racial identity, when, you know, quite often you know, what they're critiquing is the lack of intersectionality in the wider arts kind of discourse, yet when it comes to their own, you know, kind of interrogations, it's actually not that intersectional, you know, and kind of goes back to what we're saying about, you know, the lack of kind of cross analysis in relation to gender, sexuality, you know, ability and things like that. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't, it's not necessarily a question, it's just something that I'm noticing, and it's, yeah, I feel like there's a tension there.
I guess as well that feeds into like what becomes the sellable point.
Oh, Claudette.
Claudette Johnson is here.
Sorry.
Come sit down.
Please come and sit down.
Claudette needs to come and sit down. Do you want to sit here instead?
No,
you can be in the core.
No, please stay back.
Yeah.
I'll just introduce Claudette Johnson. He's one of the artists who was part of like the, as framed as part of being the Black Arts Movement, and studied here in Nottingham. Mm-hmm.
No, I studied at Wolverhampton.
Oh, in Wolverhampton.
You were part of an exhibition here at Trent, weren't you? The gallery. Yeah.
At the Midland Group.
Yeah.
The Midland Group exhibition.
Yeah. Do you want to maybe like introduce yourself briefly?
Fine.
Shall we recap?
Okay. For Claudette, we've just we showed a film that collected creativity, which I think you've seen, and we've just been doing some discussion about the global and the local, looking at who gets to frame the discourse on black art, trying to sort of, you know, foster what's happening in Britain and a British narrative. And we've just been discussing about how do we want our art to be framed as artists. And again, you know, trying to get away from the essentializing of it being this is just black art, this is just feminist art, or this is just queer art, and kind of like trying to get those threads together. And the kind of difficulties it is in. Some people have done really well, and their art is specifically about race, and that's good, that's really great. And then some people, their parts of themselves have been erased or have been pigeonholed in a certain way. I wanted to bring a question about I guess, the archive and about us. As Creative Collectivity, you know, we started this research project into, you know, looking at the Black Arts Movement because it had been missing from our art educations. And I know from speaking to some people, it was part of their art educations, but for some people, it's just one hour lesson, you know, and that's it. And that's just not really good enough. But again, about the archive, about searching for some sort of representation or something to kind of like that reflects kind of like the struggles or the politics that you want to see from art that you don't see in the mainstream. Obviously, there are some people that have done well in the mainstream, but as we were just saying before, people tend to be men, even if they are people of colour. And so, yeah, again, like searching, as this film was searching for queer artists of colour in Britain, and not just being about America, and searching for a radical politics. People who wore their radical politics, it was in their art, it was nuanced, or it was on the sleeve, but there was a sense that they had something to say, and it wasn't just about this neat hyper-catalyst, neoliberal, commercialised art world, which has always existed, don't get me wrong, but that just seems to be really dominant right now, and this seems to be a different flavour from you know, what we were uncovering that was, you know, the 80s and the 90s and all this great stuff that was being written, all these exhibitions that people were self-organizing, and again, that kind of people being in a movement, in a collective, and the solidarity that brings, and that's why, you know, working as a collective in London, as a collective creativity, it's brought us a lot of, I guess, power. It's like power for ourselves, power in, you know, having people to support each other with, you know,
and
supporting
also growing
your voice,
and nourishing,
and growing, yeah, and nourishing and healing, and that being part of the conversation rather than, you know, celebrity big name artists, and it's just being this one person who got it, did it all by themselves. Yeah. So that's kind of like where we're at. Yeah.
And so, in a sense, well, I think Claudette needs to come in, but in a sense, I think that answers the question. That answers your question in terms of framing. Mm. I mean, you have done your own framing, or in the process of doing your own framing, which is so important now in terms of art practice and in terms of the kinds of tools now which artists have to do that framing themselves. Mm. We are no longer producing just the raw material to be framed by someone else, to be framed by an art historian or a curator or a critic. Mm. Artists now are far more able to be active in terms of framing. I think you guys are a real example of that. It's fantastic. But
I mean, I was thinking about that framing question on the way here and thinking that when I was part of the Wolverhampton Young Black Artists, which was what the Black Art Group was before it became the Black Art Group, the idea of coming together as a group was that because we did share some ideas about the importance of talking in your work about Black experience and, you know, the experience of being at art college as the sole Black person in your year, and so on. Mm-hmm. And the question of framing the work, I think, was part of, you know, was when we defined ourselves as a group, we were trying to frame the work in that process, weren't we?
Yes, in terms of the conversation and the convention, the two conventions that we did, and also the symposiums and
The Pan-Afrikan Connection.
So I suppose I feel that you kind of moved things along in terms of being really, really vocal and writing and speaking about your work, kind of more volubly than I think we did at the time. I think at the time there was a lot more just about getting together, making the work, and somehow getting it out, but not worrying too much about how it was going to be talked about or defined. And over the past 30 years, I can see that that's created some, not gaps exactly, but it's created the space for other people to define the work in ways that maybe we wouldn't have chosen to define it.
Could be, but the Black Art Group, the BRK Art Group, was only a really small part of what was a much wider gender and a racial thing. And there were people in that moment which were extremely vocal.
Yeah,
and if you look at the kinds of things which the Black Audio Film Collective were saying, Lubaina, Sonia, all those kind of partner artists, who were very good at, you know.
Yeah, I thought I was thinking quite saying, narrowly about that group of
Cause the
Eddie
Black
Chambers,
group was, well, it's only three,
yourself,
yeah, four,
myself,
yeah,
and
the first Black Art Convention had so many different artists at Wolverhampton, isn't it? The first
Black
Art Convention, the
yes,
first one.
Yeah, yeah.
Like across the board.
Oh, it was very interesting.
Communities. I'm kind of interested in this thing. I'm not quite sure, I might have got the gist along that. Is there something called the Black Art now? I mean, in some ways, it's got a lot of issues I raised in this. From your point of view as a collective, did you come across that?
I mean,
you kind of define it a little bit now and again. And
I mean, one of the biggest, one of the first sessions that we did at the Tate, I think it was, which Keith attended, we were looking at then and looking at now, and like, what does the Black Arts Movement mean to artists today now? And that was one of the big questions. And we don't want to get bogged down with, you know, what is considered Black and what is considered POC or person of colour, but that does tend to be the framework that we're using now. And I guess people are looking at politics not from just a single issue. It's about kind of I don't know, identity as a whole, identity as, you know, we're talking about, you know, economics, class, disability, feminism, gender, you know, this kind of an intersection of politics, you know, yeah. and not just like one lens. I think there's someone who wants to come in into the conversation. You had your hand up. We could just get you the mic, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to say, I was sitting here thinking, is there a difference between black art and black artists? Is there a difference? Because, you know, as a black artist who may not particularly create work that's directly, overtly racial or directly, overtly, you know, gendered, are they included in this movement? Are they, is it about giving a space for black artists, or is it about giving a space for black art? Does that make any sense? Well,
Yeah. Like, I feel like I can kind of touch on that a little bit, because I think that, you know, I think that's something that we're constantly grappling with. And actually, I know that for me, kind of going through art school, you know, I found myself really kind of, you know, at odds and at tension with this idea of being a black artist, you know, and I would definitely separate, you know, black art aesthetics from what it is to be a black artist, because I think that to kind of take, I think it's a position, you know, again, I think coming back to this idea of positioning yourself, I think it's an active choice to kind of say, I'm going to present myself, I'm going to frame myself as a black artist. I mean, there's plenty of, you know, artists working today who whose work draws on black aesthetics in the sense that they might paint black people, but I don't think they would describe themselves as black artists. You know what I mean? And I think there's a real distinction there, and I think that's why, you know, I think, you know, something I've written down here is like, you know, is actually to be, you know, a black artist, is that inherently political? I don't know if it is, because I think you have to, you know, you have to make that choice about whether you want to engage with the politics of what it is to exist in a racialized body. You know, I think it's an active choice or not, you know, to put that in your work and to kind of interrogate that, you know, in aesthetic terms, but, you know, I think it has to be a choice, definitely.
I think, just going back to that V&A talk, someone was talking about how, you know, the tutor was telling them, you know, your work's too subjective, you need to make your work less black. And that person, you know, was a black person, but didn't identify their work as being black art. They were just making work about themselves. This idea that you're, you know, as racialized artists, you know, we're never, people can tell us that, our tutors or, you know, galleries or whatever institutions or the Arts Council, like, oh, this is too political, it's too about your identity. And it's like, well, that's who I am. I'm never going to get away from that, you know. And I guess, yeah, that's a double-edged sword. Is there a question? It's a question out just at the front here. Someone's been wondering, is it just a point? And then the lady with the purple hair.
Yeah, no, it's just, first of all, very reassuring to see this discussion happening here at Nottingham Contemporary, but with a new collective of thinkers, of consciousness, whether it's black consciousness or all the other terms you define, with the old guard, that's old, actually very circular, because actually, there's no such thing, because actually the concept of what we're talking about here is very much a conversation that's trying to define and redefine. Mm-hmm. And I just think that the 21st century is a moment where we're constantly redefining and being undefined, having a very undefined sort of definition of what blackness is. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, we're drawn into this mass media of being post-black even. Mm-hmm. But the issues and the points of action still remain the same. Mm-hmm. Inequality within black communities seems to be still there. The shoot and kill in America seems to be prevalent. Police brutality here, I'm sure it continues, etc. There's disharmony still. So for me today, to sit here, sitting between the ages of Keith and the collective here, although I may look more ancient than any of you.
Not at all.
Not at all.
I have to say, it's a nice equation. But I think this whole thing is about the journey. For me, it's the journey that we're on and what the new collective is learning. Because I don't think there's that many collectives that are talking about consciousness around the idea of black art. So I just wanted to make that point that it's important that this conversation is happening, particularly in a space here in Nottingham. There's much more to say.
Okay. Thank you so much for your contribution.
Yeah, somebody else?
There's another point there. That was
next one. Yeah, the person with the purple hair.
I'm the person with the purple hair. I just wanted to say that I think work, about what you were talking about, I think work is always racialized, no matter what. It can't not be racialized. I think there's a temptation to see work that's produced by white people as being sort of default human, you know.
Neutral. Normative.
Normative, yes.
Universal.
But exactly, yes. All of those things, but it's white art.
Yeah.
It's not called white art, but
I'm interested.
That's what I call it.
Yeah. Complete. I'll be really interested in seeing where when artists, white artists, start talking about race in their work, the way that their work is racialized as white. I'm still waiting for that, but anyway. Well, I'm not waiting, anyway. I think this will really...
No, I just said that. I've seen artists who are doing that now.
Yeah, I have.
There's a lot of stuff around whiteness and critical whiteness and other kinds of subject positions. And
I think we're in an interesting moment, in terms of that.
I was just thinking about one thing, a couple of things you might have mentioned regarding archive, because in some ways the film that we saw earlier... Of course, it was in Preston at the research kind of center, led by Professor Lubena Hamid. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, from that point and from that particular perspective to the 90s we're talking about, and it has been mentioned just a while ago that there's this sort of, the different stories that were kind of present there, and of course they are across the, what you call, time. And now, this kind of this dialogue. So the definition issue was even there. So in a way, it's interesting that from your investigation, from your film, your interviews, that it's kind of a very important aspect of this excavation and talking to Professor Lubena Hamid. So in a sense, it's one way where things are kind of catalogued and kind of articulated, or people have access to that reference material. So in a way, that is kind of, in a way, it's in the process. It's one of the ways, and through an individual or collective effort or institutional effort, that has happened. So in a way, unless there is that kind of position, does that mean that we need to have different positions in different places like that? Mm-hmm. I mean, the material can be disseminated, but what, you know, in terms of the archiving in one way, and then the kind of the passing
off
of the information.
Mm.
Yeah.
The
unarchiving. Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
It can happen in different levels, in different ways.
I think it's really
because
important.
That kind of touches on the issues about definitions and understanding of that particular period, not only of the, you know, then and now. It's kind of a juxtaposition.
And then the point is, it's not a, you can say then and now, but really everything's kind of moving and evolving and overlapping, uh-huh. And it's a graduation, and you know, the fact is, you know, you guys are still making work. It's not like you finished, you retired. It's not this handing over the baton. Another thing of the other thing is about access to these histories, access to these archives, and kind of the impact that has on you know, young artists of colour. So I'm just going to move on to our third and final question, which is, how do we sustain our practices during university and beyond? That's about, you know, a survival toolkit. And so, you know, we're mentioning the cross-generational conversations, which are happening here. But yeah, how do we sustain our practices during university and beyond? So, you know, I know a lot of us have struggled in isolation at universities, being, you know, one of two people of colour on our in our arts institutions, and then the kind of the struggle after that. And I think, I don't know, I want to change that. I want to see how people can move forward or move away from, you know, saying, oh, well, my institution's really racist or this happened. It's like, what can we do to sustain our practice and beyond? So after that, so collective working, sort of that kind of thing.
I just wanted to say something about something that Claudette had mentioned, which kind of relates as well to this idea of accessibility and, you know, how we sustain our practices, which was Claudette said something about you know, a generation being more vocal now, and I was thinking about you know, social media and technology and how those, in what ways do those things make it possible to be more vocal, and do those forms of technology make it more possible for certain kinds of information to be accessible, and accessible to who? Because, you know, I work with a lot of marginalized young people who don't have computers at home, for example, who don't have the internet, and so, you know, the kind of conversations that we have sometimes are really difficult because, you know, they are not necessarily accessing the wealth of information which is online, you know, where these conversations are happening. And then I look to see some young artists that are on Tumblr who are having these amazing dialogues and are finding a space to have these dialogues for themselves. But how do we kind of navigate it so that we can take those dialogues also off the internet, and you know, especially when you think about it in a cross-generational context, you know, because maybe for whatever reason there's lots of different people who wouldn't be online, and so kind of how do we work across generations but also across different technologies and geographically as well, how do we bring all of those things in together to try and sustain the conversation?
Yeah, that's a really good point. Really. And I guess just to follow on from that, I think, you know, the whole creation of the collective and us coming together was through that isolation that you mentioned, and also this erasure of history and of legacy that we have been unarchiving and doing this work. And I think that makes, like you were saying, Claudette, that makes us more vocal about our work and what we're doing and how we're organizing. And I think we do that, we do it because we have to, but then we're also kind of reflective. It's like learning from, you know, from uncovering what you were all doing. So it's more important for us to also document and archive our work and use technology and using these mediums to put out, but then also, yeah, wanting to have these conversations, because I think we've just really wanted to have cross-generational conversation to really find out, because it's also how the Black Arts Movement was depicted, co-opted, whatever words you want to use, and actually what actually happened, you know, to hear from the artists what happened. So I think we're conscious of the younger generation, the younger generation, whatever, the, you know, the future generations, and how we want to, yeah, unarchive and archive at the same time, right?
I just have a quick point to make about this thing, about the online domain. I think it's a real issue. It's a real issue still that there are kind of people, groups, age groups, etc., who don't have access to this online domain, and we do need to kind of think around strategies of kind of exposing folk to the kind of rich array of stuff which is there. However, of this thing now, in terms of one of the modules I run, the first thing which I ask young artists to kind of do is bring in a URL of a website which influences them, just to kind of get the conversation going. And I've been astounded by the kind of range of things in terms of visual art practices, which these young artists are into, that they're seeing all of this stuff, which is completely outside of the radar of what is, you know, the mainstream commercial. Yeah. They're bringing all kind of websites from everywhere, and like, what is that? And so it's like this whole idea that there is this really rich exchange, a visual exchange happening out there, and it's online. I am optimistic because more and more folk are getting online now. It was always a huge issue from the start that this was going to be an elite space, which it still is, of course. However, it's also becoming more and more ubiquitous. And I'm just really fascinated by the way that is working now to kind of really spread, you know, what young folk are looking at, and also the ability of young people to place their content online for other folk to look at. So I think that's really important.
Yeah, I suppose my
my thoughts about how we can sustain our practice, particularly maybe during university, I tend to think about the efforts I made to try and locate some kind of art practice that, you know, that talked about black experience that I could relate to. And I remember thinking at the time, you know, the US artists that I could find in the library at the time, because there was no internet, there was no, you know, it was a library, I didn't feel very connected to the work they were doing, the work of Robert Johnson and others. But when I read people like Toni Morrison and Tony K. Bambara and Alice Walker, I felt that spoke directly to my experience, and that kicked off a whole stream of work that was linked to foregrounding black experience the way that they had. And what I found at university was that when the tutors were unable to talk to me about the content of the work, they would talk about the form but not the content, and obviously I've heard that echoed again when you said, sort of my identity, I found that what they would agree to do was to bring in, I think one tutor was married to a black woman who was a poet, so she came in and talked to me about my work. It was a really valuable discussion, and I really appreciated it. So I think seek out lecturers, tutors from any discipline whose work speaks to you in some way.
Should we mention the workshop we did yesterday in the toolkit?
Oh, yes. Yeah, the workshop.
Sorry. Somebody wants to say something? Sorry.
Oh, someone waiting here.
Oh, yeah.
I was going to take the conversation slightly different way. Carrying on from what Skinder saying, it is quite interesting, aren't there, how the conversation between the two ends of the table go in some way. And it's just, to some extent, a lot of the frustrations you have about showing your work and the, is the same frustrations that people would have had in the 80s. And you know, the New Art Exchange and other galleries have taken years and years and years to develop, and you just have to get on with it. That's the nature of the work in some ways. And it is a shame there isn't something like a black bell hooks for this country. There isn't those writers and stuff, but there is so much opportunity to get work out there now. It's much easier than it used to be in some ways. But the conversation, the point I wanted to make is, one of the interesting things about the 80s that Stuart Hall wrote about was that he talked about the 80s being that conjecture point when the generation born in this country talked to the generation who came from the colonial lands. And it was that meeting point between people who wanted to build a life here, making that connection to the past. And it is, there is something that hasn't happened between that, you know, the second generation now talking to the younger. And it is quite, and there is that conversation, maybe this is the start of that type of conversation, but there is that conversation that hasn't really developed now, 20 years later.
And I wonder if part of that is the fact that, you know, okay, yeah, there are more people of colour going to university, but there's not more people of colour studying arts, you know, and in turn becoming professors, lecturers, you know, because I feel like they're, you know, because like we said, you know, kind of learning about, you know, this black arts movement was not part of our curriculum. And something I'm really interested in and thinking through is, you know, actually the racism embedded within the arts curriculum. And I think that is part and parcel because most art lecturers, professors are white. You know, there's so few. I can kind of refer really just to London, where I feel like, you know, in the kind of central London art colleges, I don't think there are any, you know, black professors other than, you know, like Keith, okay, there's Sonia, you know what I mean? Okay, there's like a few, but in terms of the, like, practice, like arts practice, like, there's very few, you know? There is very few.
Yes, I think, I mean, I've come across few, I mean, I've been to college recently, but I think there is a tendency, I don't know exactly, and if those so-called artists of colour, lecturers or whoever teaching, how would they feel? In a sense, it's kind of where does one align one's work, or who, you know, in terms of your own practice, and another within that kind of setting,
I might be the wrong person to comment on it because I'm not really fully aligned with the college at the moment. So anyway, you know, I mean, in a sense, it's an interesting debate. I kind of remember when I was a student that I hardly had any black artists coming to talk. I can't remember, to be honest with you. So in a way, some of the argument then would be that there aren't any. And then from certain exhibitions and certain writings over the years, there were people practicing. So in a sense, it's sort of a that dilemma, ironically, still exists today. It's quite pivotal in terms of not only with archives and writings and certain exhibitions that have taken place over the years. There's this debate about kind of the art school, the position in terms of lecturing or the staffing. And the sensitivity towards issues or subject matter.
Just quickly, it is an issue. It's a massive issue in terms of the numbers of people of colour or whatever.
Teaching full stop in universities.
It's going to become more of an issue because the number of teaching jobs is going to reduce. You know, and all of us are expecting a. whatever, that P45s any day, you know, simply because of the way that art is funded, that art schools are funded. There is, however, a very interesting project which is just about to be started. It's led by Sonia Boyce, and a part of that is actually looking at diversity within the curriculum. So I think that's going to be really important. We also keep our ears to the ground about that.
That at UAL at Chelsea?
Yeah, that's big UA. Yes, UAL. The UAL. Struck Middlesex thing.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Some of it, at least.
Sorry, somebody.
There's a couple of questions.
I just wanted to ask a question in terms of sort of survival. And Claudette, you were talking about the relationship between sort of literature and sort of looking to the literature. And I also am wondering about these two specific moments of now in the 80s and the relationship to political and social movements that are taking race as a central issue or the intersection of race and other kinds of identity. As intersectional kind of political movements, and so I'm kind of interested to hear a little bit more about that kind of moment of the 80s, because I think there's a kind of feeding off each other that happens within when there's a kind of broader social consciousness. And I'm also wondering about collective creativity. Where is your practice kind of fueled by that to some extent, or is it separate from that? And I'm kind of interested to what extent do you see yourselves as part of a wider social movement and political movement, or as artists kind of engaging those issues sort of separate or on the side of those movements?
That's really great. I mean, this idea of, like, I don't know, sometimes I call myself like an art activist, or you know, are you an artist or an activist? And there is a wider social movement definitely going on, and I've definitely been part of you know, like the Black Lives Matter type things and other things that are going on, you know, with housing, you know, like with protests in London, and not feeling that these two things have to be separate at all. I don't know if anyone wants to come back to that.
And likewise. In the 80s, when I was here, when we were here, it was at the same moment as there were a whole range of things like camps happening, like the peace camp agreed with, in the Common, the miners' strike, all those kinds. And so it wasn't just us. We had students, you know, who were going off to Greenham Common. We had folk who were engaged in stuff around the miners' strike. We had folk who were engaged in political actions across the board, in a sense. So it was that kind of particular sort of moment. So it's interesting to then compare it to this moment when, in a sense, there is a new, new engagement with,
like, rock against racism.
Yeah, the rock against racism.
Leeds, like a car.
You went to Leeds. I remember that. Leeds.
I didn't see you there.
You didn't see me there. You went there. The man was just too drunk. He was drinking.
Who was drunk?
We went up together.
Oh yeah, in the national bus.
See,
or whatever.
He forgets all these things.
Can't forget. Yeah, brain cells.
I mean, yeah. For me, I don't
really
feel.
Cool. That was really cool experience. That was
spilling stuff
that in
all over
itself.
The,
I'll just let Evan talk.
Yeah.
But what I think, in terms of, it's very interesting. does it have to be that one has to be aligned with a group today? Or, you know, then it wasn't necessarily. It helps, of course, and it's great to collect, because we kind of, as artists or writers, whoever, generally tend to work in isolation, and that in itself is a debate which has kind of been raised a little bit about what happens with post-college, you know what I mean, after. Because once we're, in a way, we're kind of in a setting which is sort of, might use the word comfortable, you know, in terms of our art college, when we're studying, etc. Then you are in a collective, you've got your space, you're always fighting for your little bigger space or whatever. And when you come out, you know, the reality is harsher than it always has been, and it always will be, for individuals, no matter where you come from, your racial or your politics or whatever. And even if you have money, let's assume, it's harder to maybe create, you know, the work. So in a sense, this idea of isolation and collectivity or dialogue, I think that's really important, because so in a way, college kind of really has a kind of structure, and now you have to create your own structures and objectives. Yeah. That in itself is a challenge, I think.
And one of the biggest things is, I'm going to let Raju talk. I wanted to link that up together about, you know, the first of the cuts get, you know, in our Tory government, I mean, we're looking at, you know, wider sort of things, the effect on art schools, you know, fees going up, resources going down, studio spaces disappearing, and again, the art schools are not so much this kind of safe cushion, but then obviously, you know, when you leave university, or even if you are in a collective.
Can I just say?
Yeah.
Okay, so, I think coming out of university, the main issue as an artist of colour is resources, and I think that's probably why most people go to university, and whether they get those resources or not is questionable, and we've debated that. But I think when you come out, it's about resources, and I think connecting to wider social movements, I think we have been community organisers. We organise spaces, we create platforms, we create a collective, we do residencies, because we have to. So we're connected to activism or organising because of those reasons, to create space and carve space for ourselves. And I think for me personally as an artist, resources is the biggest thing, and access to resources. And I think a lot that then it comes down to class and all these other issues of accessibility and why people don't choose to make art, which is why I was raising the question about what is art, because I think a lot of people fall short of that and don't make work because they don't consider themselves artists or capable of making art to get the resources. So for me, it's about how can we gain resources and how can we get resources. And yeah, being part of those wider social movements is really instrumental.
Being radical outside of the institutions, being within institutions, you know, what can we get out of them when we're in them? Did you want to come back?
Yeah. But yeah, also I think there is a problem around, you know, art as activism, which then sometimes it takes these, you know, social issues, political issues, and then, you know, putting them into certain spaces is like making them palatable. You know, so for example, with Black Lives Matter, you know, there's been a lot of Black Lives Matter artwork, and for on the one hand, you know, some of that has been really powerful and has been really useful to the movement, but then at the same time, you know, sometimes it becomes this consumable object. And at what point does that become a problem? You know, when you can actually buy something that says Black Lives Matter on it, what does, you know, what kind of power does that have behind it anymore? And I think that, yeah, that kind of exchange then between art and activism, and trying to find the point at which, you know, is it useful to call art activism, or at some point does it become a bit of a problem?
I mean, I think for me that's something I struggle with, this idea of like art as a kind of activism, and you know, just to kind of connect with what Raju was saying, I think, you know, I think we're all kind of connected and invested in what's going on, but I know that for me personally, like, I'm not at the front line every day, but that doesn't mean all these issues don't feed in, permeate, and the reason why I make my work, because they are. It's just, you know, I channel my energies, I channel my political energies in through my work, you know, and that's also what, and for me it's also important that I'm not directly hijacking, you know, the kind of the languages of what's going on, but actually kind of transform or translate it in a different way because of these exact reasons. I think for me it's a little problematic, I think, to kind of, you know, because in a way, you know, whether it's a kind of financial capital, in a way you're kind of profiting off, you know, a social capital, whatever, you're kind of profiting off, you know, kind of the what's going on, which for me I find a little, yeah, ethically precarious. Yeah.
I've just got a quick resource question.
There's a person been waiting for a while to speak. Sorry.
It was just really following on the question about sustainability and where you go as artists, and I think it comes back to that kind of no man is an island. So we are fed by society, and the influence you have on people around you, family, friends, and the people or even institutions you engage with on a day-to-day basis. And I think there still is many issues to be addressed within the arts about clearly the black presence in gallery spaces and arts administration. There's loads of issues to be addressed, and that shouldn't really be undermined. And then just for as the individual artist, I think you get to a point where it's your passion what drives you forward, and you find your own subject matter, but then it's always going to be driven by your passion to follow that subject matter.
Did you want to speak as well? Yeah, sorry. I'm going to bring the mic over here.
Just want to quickly throw my two pants in. I may need your help, Zaid.
Oh, yeah.
At Radio Nottingham in the 80s, I made features, you know, I worked there. And the features were mainstream, the subject matter. But they were thrown into Asian programs or, you know, non-white programs, non-mainstream programs, because of my color or whatever. And that was automatic. You know, sometimes stuff got spun off. But even when things were syndicated to World Service, they'd go into the sort of like an Indian or Asian. But in the States, anything I did, nobody gave a damn about whether I was brown, black, or whatever. You know, when we did the thing at Westbeth, it wasn't like, hey, you know, this guy's made a movie. Westbeth is a big art space in Manhattan. And I showed some films I'd made there. You could call them indie films. Saeed showed some work at the same time. But there was never any thought about whether our background, our color. I don't know how this contributes to everything we've been talking about now, but I just wanted to throw that in. And I know other guys, you know, who are of a brown or a black background in the States. And actually, when I think about it, and I think about Saeed, and I think about, okay, he's brown or black, and he applies because he gets grants because he's brown or black. And I think in the States, I remember saying to him once, I don't know how this is relevant, but again, I'm going to throw it out there. Man, there's guys on the streets in Soho selling their work for more than you are, and they're not even artists, man. So it's like you make a bit of work, who's buying it? It isn't, you know, I wonder if there's a background to a lot of these conversations here where, well, I'm black and I'm brown. And I feel it works in Europe like this, from living on the continent as well, but, you know, especially here. You get a grant or you get a, you know, a pass or whatever because you're brown or black. But my experience in the States, and I realize all my experiences are myopic, they're my experience. Every brown, black, or yellow, or whatever person out there, you get your money for your work. And is somebody buying it?
I think
end of story. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, maybe they were. I think in terms of, I saw a photograph, I mean, kind of one example of the Black Panther movement. But they were, I mean, it'd be hard for me to comment on what was happening or what's happening in terms of finance or grants in states. It's very complex. But I think there were places where, I'm sure, there were, you know, aspects where people could kind of develop certain types of work, the music or whatever expression they were working on. It wasn't that it doesn't exist. I think, of course, it exists. And there's been a great kind of challenge even for artists in America to kind of confront Washington museums or whatever, you know, collections, etc. So it's kind of interesting you mentioned that it's really complex, and it kind of touches on a couple of works up there, and the themes of certain photographs or certain artworks that are in this exhibition, importantly what you just said. But there's been the dynamics of politics, etc.
There's a difference in politics. I think, you know, when you have a very very capitalist system in America where everything's valued by its, you know, its monetary gain. Mm. There's this idea of color blindness being progression. Like, we don't see race. You're just an artist. We just take your value as face value, and that actually can be detrimental. It's not because people get a grant from the ACE because they're black or brown. It's, you know, because they've written a great proposal. But the idea that, like, you know, it was because color blindness. So, you know, this work is what it is, we don't see race, I think takes away from the fact certain works are made by certain people, and, you know, the background or the culture or the migration or the stories or the race behind that person impacts the end product. You know, I think, you know, if you've got white artists making appropriative work about black people, it's going to be interpreted as racist. It's going to be interpreted as there's a difference to this work being made than it is to being a black person. But I guess, you know, there are different models of history, colonialism, racism that happen in the UK and Europe and happen in the US. So there's going to be different conversations about that. So, you know, we've got about, you know, 5 or 10 minutes to, like, wrap up and things. I want to go back to, like, you know, looking at university and kind of, like, you know, surviving at university. I remember that Kimothy Donkor, I think he is, when he was at Goldsmiths, I think he lectures now at UAL in London. So he always recounts this experience in the 90s about when, you know, they wrote this letter and wrote down, we want... sorry, Emma? So it was saying, oh, we want these, we've got no black art lecturers, we want Sonia Boyce and, you know, this person to come and teach us and spell people's names wrong, and then people, you know, and then Sonia Boyce started teaching there after that in the 90s. You know, we come back to now, you've got, you know, certain people are teaching, people are going to, you know, eventually, you know, do their MAs and PhDs and, you know, be teaching in these institutions, and that, you know, certain universities have got initiatives like Shades of Noir, which are about retaining and employing and getting more people of colour, professors and studentships and, you know, tutors, you know, working in art schools and beyond. But,
I just had a really prosaic and quick question. It goes all the way back to Raj's question about resources and shared resources in isolation. Mm. The question I asked of space, of physical space, in terms of, I mean, how are you guys as a collective now finding, you know, issues around space? Yeah. Or really, as a collective, do you find that you're able to collectively access space? Which I think is one of the kind of key ways in which artists post-university can really form a community, and actually it's actually becoming almost an alternative to university. Because if you think about if university costs, an MA now costs $9,000 a year or whatever, you know, if there are 5 artists, you know, who kind of pitch together their $9,000, you know, you could buy some nice, you could get some nice space for them.
We don't have $9,000.
Invite the people in that you want, you know. But you don't have $9,000, of course, but, you know, just incrementally. You know, it's kind of, so there's this other alternative thing which can happen now in terms of artists engaging in mutual support and creating new kind of structures which are now away from the formal university, in a sense. Mm.
Exchange of knowledge.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that we're constantly thinking about, really, is space. You know, I think kind of in the past, we've kind of held sessions informally at kind of institutions, spaces that we've had access to, could get hold of for free. You know, we've done kind of residencies here and there at, you know, different spaces in London as well. But, you know, at the moment, this kind of question of, you know, a constant space that we can kind of use to kind of work from, but also kind of hold events, you know, things like that, is something that we're thinking about. But then, you know, the reality is, it's like, you know, living in London, like, things are so expensive, you know, when we're kind of living in a time where, you know, sometimes we can barely pay our rent, let alone kind of have this space that we can kind of work from, you know, every day or whatever. So it's, yeah, it's definitely a challenge. Like,
yeah. Quick question from the Nottingham folk. What's Nottingham like now in terms of space?
It's that.
Are there artists collecting
spaces?
It's great,
spaces, I think
there?
So.
There used to be some great spaces.
It's quite good.
Yeah. From Brighton. Which gallery, which studio is it?
It's like in Spencer, just down from the Artist Media sort of thing.
Yeah.
And it's very that sort of like, I don't know, I find it quite Saatchi-ish.
But from Brighton?
Saatchi.
Can I just talk about space? The Surface Gallery is actually an incredible space. I'm a volunteer there. It's all volunteer-led. Mm-hmm. They also have residencies upstairs. And we had London Revolutionaries come, and that was... it was just amazing. It's just like you can go there. They welcome anyone. You know, you can go in there, walk in and say, I want to get involved. Doesn't matter what background you're from. I think it's about making art accessible. I think that's the most important thing when we talk about reaching and spaces. It's about actually being innovative in what space you're using, because at the end of the arts, everything, anything, you know, you can be so creative with the space you're using, you know, and intervention, I think, is so key to kind of getting a message or getting... you know, whatever you're doing out there, and actually being innovative in creating situations and what space you're using. Because I think that's something that actually contemporary artists have been doing more lately. You know, I've seen garages converted and, you know, old buildings turned to something new and, you know, public intervention, public dance or music or... And it's beautiful, you know. I think Nottingham has a great movement. And, you know, everywhere, to be fair, it's more people are getting into art, more people have something to say, and young people, and everyone is driving that. You know, there's a lot of youth centres, a lot of community centres that are driving that force. So I think that's quite an important thing anyway, sorry.
Thank you. Well, we are pretty much, we've got like 1 minute left, so we either let someone speak or we can wrap up. What do you think?
I just wanted to say about people setting up their own spaces, you know, because Keith touched upon something about people not being able to go to university because of the £9,000 fees a year. But then that, again, brings up its own problem, because there's a lot of these kind of free schools starting up, you know, Open School East in London, for example. But then the problem arises of who can afford to do virtually a full-time course without it being accredited, who has the money then to fund that for themselves. So there are some people who are setting up their own schools, but then that sometimes can become a privileged activity. And then the other kinds of spaces, you know, things like how squatting law has changed, and gentrification, people getting pushed out of spaces. So, you know, a lot of spaces like my studio is a Network Rail space, and, you know, Network Rail are making a lot of changes, which means that a lot of those spaces are disappearing. How gentrification, you know, really closes down the amount of spaces that people have access to as well.
Okay, one last quick question.
I just want to say, well, the question of space was actually a really key question for me, but I just wanted to say that I attended the symposium in Sheffield, and the one at Wolverhampton, sort of, you know, looking at the you know, the reflection of the Black Art Group research, and I remember being at the symposium at conference rather at Wolverhampton, and having a conversation with my friend Christine, and we were asking the question, where were the young voices? Because whilst it was all very kind of, it was like, where, you know, where are these voices going to come from? Who are these artists, basically? So it's really amazing that this is happening. And for me personally, you know, if somebody wants to kind of like engage, you know, with the conversations and what's happening, particularly in the UK, not just across visual art, but across all, you know, various different art sectors. I'm quite involved in the dance side of things. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that that is, I mean, the fact that this is happening is great, and I think what, you know, the fact that Nottingham Contemporary are supporting this, and I guess there was a question for me, kind of, who approaches you and who are you approaching? Mm. Where is your home for these conversations, and are these conversations going to be, you know, migrating across, you know, across the country? Because, you know, we need to be able to hear the voices across the whole country, not just, you know, the voices in London. And it's brilliant that this is happening here. And I think that. I'm getting so excited. But it is, because there's a huge legacy here, and that needs to be, it has been mined, because it's been very much part of, I think, shaping this particular institution. There are certain individuals that, have had a great input into the manifestation of this, and I guess its programmes, no doubt. But the other thing as well for me, it's really encouraging to hear Skinder down there, because I was looking around wondering, is there a representative from the New Art Exchange here? and it's really great, you know, that people are, you know, sort of coming out. Sorry, am I waffling? but I wanted to say about the conversations, sort of, you know, travelling around the country. I also wanted to say something about joining the dots, really, across the Atlantic, that are sort of in between the spaces of the biennales and everything, because I spend quite a bit of time over in Gambia, West Africa, and Senegal, and there are artists there that are kind of struggling with the idea of even being an artist, let alone about creating work and how to have conversations about it. And then just to sort of quickly just make a mention about the issues that you were talking around education. There are other kind of links that are taking place within different sectors as well, you know, with for instance, like Association of Dance for the African Diaspora now kind of linking up with the critical kind of dance organisations in the UK to be able to you know, examine the deficits that are taking place within that sector. And I just wonder about making joining those dots within the sectors as well, where the same conversations are having are being had across the different sectors. So, you know, for instance, like state of emergency at the moment, are creating work is where is home, looking at stories from here, America and Johannesburg. So it's, I know I might have kind of like waffled quite a bit, but I guess I'm trying to ask a bit about where is that kind of that whole thing about home, and who's approaching you, who are you approaching, and what are the kind of opportunities for the institutions to open up and have you present in the programme and the, you know, the decisions for programming, basically. Sorry, that was a really long way of saying.
That's okay, thank you. I'm just going to take this question and then we'll be able to wrap up. Yeah.
No, it wasn't a question. I was actually
a point, sorry.
Nottingham and space.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah.
Apart from the surface gallery, there's the backlit studios. There's several studios, because I've been looking for studios within the past year at reasonable prices. And I finally, after I've had about 4 studios in over 30 years, and there's a lot of good studio space available in Nottingham right now at reasonable prices, far better than London.
Oh, far cheaper as well. You know, I was going to say, is there anybody from Trent staff, or I'm just interested to know in here, because it's sort of linked with our kind of this conversation started with that. And I'm just wondering.
Yeah, any Trent people? Yeah.
Any Trent?
Not
students.
Trend. Oh, look there.
Staff, students? Yeah.
Oh, literature, not fine arts. So where's it from?
And where is literature based? In the city area or Clifton? Right, that's very interesting.
Okay, amazing.
Sorry?
Oh, okay, the one last person who is going to talk, and then we're definitely going to have to wrap up.
I'll make this really quick, but just responding to what the lady was saying about starting the conversation. My name's Connie, I'm curator at Wolverhampton Art Gallery. I'm curating the Black Art Project, which is an HLF collecting cultures project. I want to do some sort of intergenerational conversation group or something. The project is still very embryonic. I started early March. So if anyone is interested in doing something, do come and sort of corner me at the end of the evening. I'm quite happy to sort of talk with you guys and see where we can go from this. So, hello.
Amazing.
Are you curating something?
Yes, I am. Uh-huh. There's no
exhibition. No, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because even though Wolverhampton was so central to the in the art group, we didn't actually have any works in the collection that represent Wolverhampton. So we identified that.
It's an excellent show on there now, though, isn't it?
What's that?
Yara Shabani. Yara El Shabani.
Oh, Yara.
Who?
Fantastic.
Who's that?
She's great. Was that the one really that was the art exchange?
Yeah. Oh, yes, okay. It was. Yeah, yeah. Yes. So, no, you guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yara, yeah, Shabani. Yeah, yeah, with the quiz show.
Looks really nice over there.
Well, you know, I mean, we can carry on the conversation, like, you know, over a drink, but I think we do have to...
Yeah, with the timing.
What's the train time?
is there anyone on the panel who wants to do any closing remark? Maybe Claudia or...
Okay,
no. Well, I just really want a big thank you to Jana and Merce, you know, Nottingham Contemporary for having us and for showing film, and you know, we were able to do a workshop yesterday with some younger students. That was really brilliant. You know, we're just excited to have these conversations, and it doesn't stop here. We keep doing them, we keep having them, we record them, we've been filming today, disseminating on our blog. Keep in touch, and you know, we're on Twitter and all that malarkey. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cameron.